Hello students, looking at current affairs for 21st May, the news items picked up from the Hindu newspaper are these 18. We looked at them in detail. The first one, Amphan batters West Bengal, Orisha. So the super cyclonic storm Amphan made landfall near Sagar Islands of Sundarbans in West Bengal and has killed 3 persons. It has also affected 4 coastal districts of Orisha. So thousands of kacha houses in the coastal parts of West Bengal were damaged. And this is said to be one of the fiercest super cyclone of West Bengal in recent years, more powerful than even last year's cyclone Bulbul of West Bengal and Ayla of a decade earlier of 2009 in West Bengal. So this is the detail regarding cyclone Amphan. Its route is shown here. Then next is locusts cross Thar desert to invade 16 districts in Rajasthan. So invasion of locusts. So locusts are actually grasshoppers. So they're species of grasshoppers and they have started moving from India-Pakistan border into the state of Rajasthan on April 11. They have crossed Thar desert and affected 16 of the 33 districts in Rajasthan. And this is because of the favorable wind conditions. The onset of summer, they are moving towards India. And these locust swarms have traveled far in search of food because lack of vegetation in agricultural fields after the rabi crop harvests sees that they don't get enough food. And now they are settling on babul and khejri trees in Rajasthan. Agriculture department says they have controlled the outbreak, but steps need to be taken. This was seen even last year. In 2019 also, we had discussed how the locust invasion took place after a gap of 26 years. In 2019 and now 2020, again we are seeing locust invasion from India-Pakistan border. So this has damaged, last year it had damaged crops across 6.7 lakh hectares in 12 districts in Rajasthan, and loss was pegged at 1000 crores. So they actually come from Africa. They emerged in January 2019 from Eastern Africa and they traveled through Saudi Arabia, the Middle East, Iran, and then entered Pakistan, from where they entered into India. In Pakistan also, they invaded the cotton producing belt of Sindh. So these Eti locusts, they flew into the Indian side of Thar desert. And last year also, they damaged crops not just in Rajasthan, but also in Gujarat. And it is said that government is taking initiatives. High intensity Melithion insecticide is being sprayed through tractors. And even drones are proposed to be used to spray pesticides in areas inaccessible to vehicles. Even UNFAO, UN Food and Agriculture Organization, has recently warned that locusts were breeding in large numbers in Sudan and Eritrea of Africa's Red Sea coast, as well as in Iran, and they may move towards India. So here you can see, this is the Horn of Africa from where these locusts emerge and they have entered into India. This is the last year's coverage, how these locusts have affected the country and how, though the infestation we had seen was declining, now since last year it has come up again. Then next is domestic flights to resume on May 25. So domestic flights across the country will resume on May 25 after 2 month ban since 25 March. And government is also going to cap the airfares for different routes. So airports will operate at 1/3 the capacity. Airlines will also start 1/3 of their flights. But then it is said airlines will not be required to leave seats empty, as was stated earlier, but the passengers will be required to wear face shields, etc. And there's no plan for international flights presently to resume them. Then next is Nepal's new political map unacceptable, says India. So Nepal has unveiled a new official map and it shows Kalapani, Limpiadhura and Lipulekh of Uttarakhand as part of Nepal. So this new map being unveiled has been called unacceptable by India. It is called artificial, and this unilateral act, it is not based on historical facts and evidence too, and it is contrary to the bilateral understanding to resolve outstanding boundary disputes through diplomatic dialogue. But Nepal diplomatic sources say that region of Kalapani and its adjoining areas, the east of river Kali and Susta on the Uttar Pradesh-Bihar border, are only parts of nearly 1,800 kilometer long boundary which India and Nepal share, but this part is only the unresolved part. And Nepal is now showing a new map with these regions in its territory. Nepal says India has encroached upon this territory and wants India to evacuate its population and location. its population to from the location. So this all is in the context of within the newly inaugurated Dharchula-Lipulekh link road. So this is a road which India has inaugurated, which is actually cuts travel time for Mansarovar pilgrims. So this is a disputed region, and India's construction here has resulted in Nepal also becoming active and showing a new map and claiming this territory. And Nepal Prime Minister K.P. Sharma Oli said his government was willing to give a road towards Tibet on lease to India, but will not surrender the region. So this is the region you can see in Uttarakhand in India, which Nepal claims. So this is Kalapani region you can see. And this is the Lipulekh Pass, and this is Mount Kailash. Sorry, this is Mount Kailash in Tibet, and the Mansarovar Lake. So Kailash Mansarovar Yatra, which takes place. This is the route which is taken. So the route under repair, which has resulted in this dispute arising, is here, starting from Dharchula. Then next is China accuses India of trespass. LAC heats up. So now China has accused Indian Army of crossing into its territory and blocking its patrols and attempting to unilaterally change the status of LAC, Line of Actual Control, which is the boundary between India and China. So this dispute has arisen in the two regions, which are in Sikkim and in Ladakh. So military commanders have been holding talks to diffuse the tension. But now even Indian side had said earlier, it was in news, and India said that these are local level disputes which have arisen, which have been resolved at local level. But now China's Ministry of Foreign Affairs has referred to these recent skirmishes in Sikkim as the Indian Army. They claim that Indian Army crossed the line across the western section of Sino-India border and the Sikkim section to enter Chinese territory. So Ministry of Foreign Affairs is accusing Indian Army of entering Chinese territory. So now tensions are escalating at the LAC too. This is said to be the most serious event which has taken place since the Doklam face-off in 2017. And this is Sikkim's Nakula Pass. This is actually said to be one of the four areas that has seen aggressive action between the troops since April 2020, since last month. Even in Ladakh, in the Pangong So Lake, and in Demchok and other regions too, there have been skirmishes. So both sides have rushed personnel to this area. At Demchok, it is said a huge accumulation of Chinese troops is taking place. So this is the region. About Doklam also, you know, should know that Doklam is a tri-junction area near Chumbi Valley, which is under Chinese control, but Bhutan claims sovereignty over it. So in 2017, this dispute arose, and it was actually a territorial dispute between China and Bhutan, but India on behalf of Bhutan intervened, and there was a standoff. So this was at this tri-junction in Sikkim only, and China at that time had alleged that Indian troops entered the Chinese site in Doklam, which is known as Donglong in China, and India objected to China building a road here near the tri-junction. And further escalation of this standoff resulted in China barring entry of pilgrims to Kailash Mansarovar from Nathula border too. So this tension got de-escalated, and now we are seeing fresh tensions emerging here, in which China claims that India is entering into its territory. Then next is, border disputes a reminder of threat posed by China. So this is US top diplomat, she is Alice Wells, who is the top diplomat for South and Central Asia region for USA. She has called the recent tensions between India and China along the LAC as reminder of the threat posed by China. So US-China relationships are also strained. Already they were strained due to trade disputes, and now because of US accusation of China's mismanagement of coronavirus pandemic has resulted in further straining of relations between the two countries. And they have spoken how China has become a threat. It is unilaterally taking action. It shows provocative and disturbing behavior, be it in South China Sea or along India border. So this is being stated by her. She says China's behavior is causing other nations to group together to reinforce the post-Second World War economic order. And she gives examples of various groupings, including the Quad grouping. We have seen the Quad grouping, which includes India, USA, Japan and Australia. So this is the Quad grouping. So she speaks about that too. And she also said that China's global infrastructure project has been a concern. So on the question on that, even since China's Belt and Road Initiative, the global infrastructure project is assisting various countries in infrastructure development, including in India's neighborhood in Nepal. USA has also intervened. USA has provided a grant assistance. It is said not loan, but grant assistance of $500 million. But there is a controversy which has erupted between ruling Nepal Congress Party and the opposition, Nepal Communist Party, over this grant assistance, acceptance of this from USA. So this was seen as an alternative to China's Belt and Road Initiative, but China has to sign on to it. It has not done yet. So this is China's Belt and Road Initiative too, you can see. It includes land route as well as sea route, connecting China to countries up to Europe, you can say. India has also objected to Belt and Road Initiative because China-Pakistan Economic Corridor, which is part of Belt and Road Initiative, passes through POK, which India objects to because it affects its sovereignty. Because POK is under Pakistan control presently, and having a road for Pakistan through it is objected to. And India has not joined Belt and Road Initiative. Then next is Russian team at Kudankulam to address problems in generators. So this is regarding Kudankulam nuclear power project, which is in Tamil Nadu. So here a problem arose. There were unusual vibrations taking place in the generator section of the second reactor here. So each reactor has a power generation capacity of 1000 megawatts. These are VVAR reactors procured from Russia by NPCL, that is Nuclear Power Corporation of India Limited. So two are functional presently, and three and four are under construction. Even excavation work for fifth and sixth reactors is progressing. So second reactor saw a problem, and we had the Russian technocrats, a seven-member Russian technocrat team, coming here to look into the matter. It's said to be India's biggest nuclear plant site, aimed to improve electricity generation of the country with Russian assistance. Each of 1000 megawatts, 6 VVAR are planned here. Unit 1 became operational. It attained criticality in 2013. It's mentioned here. The first generator has been generating power since July 2013. Then next is Birla orders review of house panels work. So Lok Sabha Speaker Om Birla has initiated an exercise to assess the effectiveness of parliamentary standing committees. So parliament stopped functioning abruptly. The session ended on March 23, and since then even departmentally related standing committees have not met, and opposition parties have been demanding that there be online meetings held of departmentally related standing committees, which includes both Lok Sabha committees, Rajya Sabha committees, and even joint committees. So the Lok Sabha secretariat and Rajya Sabha secretariat are looking into this. Earlier they said that this cannot take place because online meets cannot take place because confidentiality clause will be violated if the meeting is held by video conference. But now with further pressure, it has been said that NIC, National Informatics Center, will provide a safe platform and this demand can be met. And in that context, now Lok Sabha Speaker has initiated an exercise to assess the effectiveness of parliamentary standing committees. Means it's looking at the rate of attendance at the meetings so far and the list of recommendations that have not been accepted by the government. So that has been looked into. Then next is new scheme for Chhattisgarh farmers. So this is regarding Rajiv Gandhi Kisan Nyay Yojana, which has been inaugurated now on 21st May 2020, which is the 19th death anniversary of former Prime Minister Rajiv Gandhi. It has been announced by Chhattisgarh government. And farmers in Chhattisgarh under this Yojana would get 13,000 rupees an acre a year, every year. So this is a new income support scheme announced. So first installment for this scheme is going to cost 1,500 crore rupees. And it is said to benefit 18 lakh farmers, out of which more than 80% are small and marginal farmers. And the annual cost of this scheme is said to be around 5,700 crores. So farmers would be covered, all farmers. Initially, it is rice, maize and sugarcane farmers which are being covered, and later it is said will be expanded to other crops. So rice and maize farmers would get 10,000 rupees per acre, while sugarcane farmers would get 30,000 rupees per acre. And this amount will be paid in four installments over the year. So Chhattisgarh, it is said, receives more than 50 inches of rainfall annually, but irrigation facilities need improvement. Farmers are able to cultivate only one season and they take up allied activities, so this amount is going to help them in that. Even Chhattisgarh, last year it is said in 2019, paid farmers above the central minimum support price, and center disapproved of this. And state government was told if it continued with the incentive, its rice would not be entirely picked up in the central pool. So this was the threat being given as such. And state said that we were attempting to meet the Swaminathan Commission standards so that farmers must get 150% of the cost of production at as MSP. So they were paying higher MSP, and which was not approved. So now the chief minister says that this new scheme would compensate the farmers through a different track now. So this is NYAY. Then next is UK trial to test efficacy of 5 drugs. So with a range of approved drugs now being tested for COVID-19, there's no clarity which one will be more effective, but this is a test being done under even the University of Oxford. So this trial has studying the effectiveness of 5 drugs actually. So one is the anti-inflammatory drug tocilizumab. And then there are HIV drugs, second, that is combination of lopinavir and ritonavir, and then anti-inflammatory corticosteroid, which is dexamethasone, an anti-malarial drug hydroxychloroquine, and finally the fifth one is antibiotic azithromycin. So all of these are being tested for the efficacy to treat COVID-19. Then next is only 2,132 used अब आयुष्मान भारत प्रधानमंत्री जन आरोग्य योजना फॉर COVID-19 ट्रीटमेंट. सो टेस्टिंग एंड ट्रीटमेंट फॉर COVID-19 इज फ्री फॉर 53 करोड़ बेनिफिशरीज ऑफ इंडियाज प्रधानमंत्री जन आरोग्य योजना द पेपरलेस हेल्थ केयर स्कीम विच वॉज लॉन्च इन सेप्टेम्बर 2018. इट प्रोवाइड्स अ कवर ऑफ अप टू 5 लाख रुपीज पर फैमिली फॉर सेकेंडरी एंड टर्शरी केयर हॉस्पिटलाइजेशन. नेशनल हेल्थ अथॉरिटी इज मैंडेटेड टू इम्प्लीमेंट द स्कीम एंड इट हैज एम्पेनल्ड हॉस्पिटल्स. You can see 21,565 hospitals have been empaneled. Presently, more hospitals on the express route have been empaneled. So, they are also, many are private hospitals too, which have been empaneled so that COVID-19 treatment can also be provided for free. But so far, it is said only 2,132 people use this route for COVID-19 treatment. So, you can see this is a detail about Ayushman Bharat Pradhan Mantri Jan Arogya Yojana, which we just discussed. So it is a paperless cashless scheme. So its identity confirmation, preferably through Aadhaar, is required under it. Then next is Assam lets off 308 foreigners. So Supreme Court had directed on March 23 to decongest jails in the context of COVID-19. So based on that, now Assam's infamous detention centers have been proposed to be decongested. 308 out of 802 declared foreigners have been released, and they have, the remaining would also said to be released based after they are secure, after sureties are secured from them. So these are declared foreigners. A declared foreigner means a person who is marked by any of the 100 foreigners tribunals in Assam for allegedly failing to prove their citizenship after the state's police border wing detected them as illegal migrant. So these detention camps, there are these detention camps in Assam where you can see men, women and children have been detained in these 6 detention centers. So now they are being released, it seems. 308 out of 100 and 802 have been released. Then next is Abbas says Israel's annexation plan has derailed Oslo Accord. So this is regarding Israel government. We have seen new Israel Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu in his recent election campaign had stated that if he comes to power, he'll extend Israel's sovereignty over Jordan Valley and the Jewish settlements, totaling about 30% of the territory. So such claims, and after he been coming to power, showing his intent to go ahead with this of annexing Palestinian land, has resulted in Palestinian Authority leader, the president in West Bank, Mahmoud Abbas, to declare that it is free of its commitment now under the Oslo Peace Accord because it has already been violated by Israel. So the understanding which was there, which ensured that the two recognized each other's existence, will no longer hold. This Oslo Accord came in 1993, which was brokered by then US President Bill Clinton between Israel and Palestinian Liberation Organization, PLO. So this it actually made PLO recognize Israel's right to exist and renounced use of violence. So they wanted Palestine and Israel to coexist as two nations. Otherwise, the Palestinian Liberation Organization did not recognize Israel as a nation and claimed the entire region belonging to it. So this was the 1993 Oslo Accord, which did not go down well even in Israel. So the Israeli Prime Minister Rabin, who had signed this deal, actually got assassinated by an Israeli in 1995. So this Israeli peace accord resulted in further progress in peace taking place here, and autonomy for Palestinians in West Bank and Gaza was ensured in return of agreement to renounce violence and acknowledge the existence of Israel. So this is then next is Israel and Iran take their battle online. So Israel is said to be behind a cyber attack which took place on May 9 that disrupted operations at a major port in Iran. This was Shahid Rajai port in strategically important Strait of Hormuz. So here you can see the attack did not cause much damage, and it was said to be retaliation to a failed Iranian cyber attack on Israeli water facility in April 2020. So now cyber war has initiated, it seems, between Iran and Israel. Then next is Cabinet approves 3 lakh crore funding for micro, small and medium enterprises. So the Union Cabinet has approved an additional funding of 3 lakh crores to micro, small and medium enterprises, and this is part of the announcement which has already been made by Finance Minister Nirmala Sitharaman as part of the 20 lakh crore economic package, Atmanirbhar Bharat Yojana. So under this, now this 3 lakh crore details have been provided. The Union Cabinet has approved it. So it will be 100% guarantee coverage which will be provided. Means this amount is given as loan funding for micro, small and medium enterprises, and they will be guaranteed. There will be 100% guarantee coverage by National Credit Guarantee Trustee Company Limited. So this will be provided to eligible micro, small and medium enterprises and even interested borrowers of the Mudra scheme, which is also for micro enterprises. So this will be a guaranteed emergency credit line facility, and the tenure of this loan said to be 4 years with a moratorium period of 1 year. The interest rates on these have been capped. For banks, interest rate charged by banks will be 9.25%, and for NBFCs it will be 14%. So this interest will have to be paid, and all MSE borrowers accounts with outstanding credit of up to 25 crores as of February 2020, which was less than or equal to 60 days. So they are not overdue, and annual turnover is up to 100 crores, they would be eligible for this funding. So bankers actually say that the government is not giving direct guarantee. Guarantee is being given through National Credit Guarantee Trustee Company Limited. So this will not solve the risk averse issue that the lenders are facing. The scheme is not directly guaranteed, so banks will have to attach a risk weight of 20% for the loans. So that is a concern for banks. So though the scheme has been announced, but they are not happy. Also, other schemes approved by the cabinet under Ayushman Bharat, which are under Atmanirbhar Bharat, are of about 3,110 crore rupees for distribution of extra food grains to about 8 crore migrant workers and their families. Then a new centrally sponsored scheme to support micro food processing units, which is having a 10,000 crore outlay. And the scheme will be implemented over a 5-year period with the center state share at 60:40. Then another one is Pradhan Mantri Matsya Sampada Yojana, which was already announced in 2020 budget. So this is for the fisheries sector, 5-year scheme. So this has also been approved by the Union Cabinet presently. It will have a total investment of 20,050 crores. And then also Cabinet Committee on Economic Affairs approved adoption of new methodology for auction of coal and lignite blocks on revenue sharing basis. And tenure of coking coal linkage has also been increased. And it has approved permission for commercial exploitation of coal bed methane in mining areas. So what is coal bed methane also, we'll see in detail. So these are the decisions which have been taken. Credit coverage for micro, small and medium enterprises with guarantee coverage by NCGTC. So this is regarding Pradhan Mantri Matsya Sampada Yojana 2 for fisheries development over 5-year period. and this is regarding coal bed methane. So this is the gas, you can see in the coal bed methane gas is released, which is extracted. So it's actually a steel encased hole which is drilled into the coal seam, and you can see water through hydrostatic pressure, you can see water is out, comes out, and you can see methane pipeline is there, which results in methane pipe being extracted. So water pressure within the coal bed is reduced, and when the pressure is decreased, methane gas naturally desorbs from the coal and migrates through the coal beds and is released through this pipe. Commercial exploitation of coal bed methane is now being allowed. The next is Cabinet okays non-banking finance companies liquidity plan. So Union Cabinet has approved 30,000 crore special liquidity scheme for non-banking finance companies and housing finance companies aimed at improving the cash position of these entities. So a special purpose vehicle will be set up by a public sector bank to manage the stressed asset fund. So whose special securities would be guaranteed by the Government of India and purchased by RBI. So this is the special purpose vehicle. But it will acquire short-term debt. So directly guarantee is given here by the government. And purchase of these will be by the RBI itself. But then it is to acquire short-term debt of at least investment grade of eligible non-banking finance companies, housing finance companies, etc. So this will be administered by Department of Financial Services. But then again, the industry body of NBFC says that this will not be beneficial. Its scheme is a non-starter because it is giving short tenure funds. And funds will be made available for only up to a tenure of 3 months. And while majority of the lending done is for a tenure of 2 to 3 years. So these are non-banking finance companies. These are lending companies, housing finance companies. They provide finance. So they give finance for 2 to 3 years. When government is providing for short term of 3 months, so this is an asset liability mismatch which will occur. And this will not be beneficial. Though here in this case, direct guarantee by the government is given, but still it is not acceptable, it is said. So this is there. Then next is, center releases 46,038 crore to states as tax devolution for May. So Union government has released 46,038 crore rupees to states as their share of central taxes and duties for May 2020. So calculation for this has been done on the basis of the tax receipts projections in budget 2020-21 and not according to actuals. Actuals will be actually low because of COVID-19 pandemic, but still government has released the amount to the states. The first installment has also been released as such of 5,005 crores to states, which is the first installment of a finance commission grant for smaller cities. So this is going to go to cities, non-million plus cities, smaller cities with population below 1 million. So funds, I said, have to be passed on directly to urban local bodies within 10 days. And delay of beyond 10 days, it is said, will result in states to pay interest on it. So these are untied grants, means the cities, local bodies can use these funds for any location specific needs, but cannot be used to pay salaries or the establishment expenditure. So funds to states as well as to cities, small cities, have been released by the center. And the last news is, IIT Guwahati takes Trojan horse route to fight Alzheimer's disease. So this is IIT Guwahati, which has after a 5-year study arrived at a method to prevent accumulation of neurotoxin molecules in the brain. So Alzheimer's is actually a disease which results in this accumulation of amyloid beta peptides in the brain. So these neurotoxin molecules in the brain lead to memory loss. So what it has done is it has used two ways. One is the use of Trojan peptides. So these Trojan peptides act like Trojan horse of ancient Greek mythology, ancient Greek stories of how Troy victory came. So this is actually a deceitful peptide with negative syncretical points. So it checks the plaque formation. So plaque formation takes place over these peptides. So peptide molecules need to have a particular structure to aggregate. So these actually will result in these aggregation not taking place. And also it has another method which is of applying low voltage electric field. So this will result in preventing amyloid plaques from aggregating. So these two steps can result, a Trojan peptide and low voltage electric field can result in these accumulations not taking place and Alzheimer's disease not progressing. So this is there. So this said, through intravenous injection of the Trojan peptide, we can retard the degeneration of nerve cells by 17% to 35%, translating in a 10-year delay in the onset of the disease. some 100 potential drugs for treatment of Alzheimer's disease have actually failed. Researchers have failed between 1998 and 2011. And now IIT Guwahati researchers have come up with this development of a cure for the disease. And it is important for India because India comes third in number of Alzheimer's patients after China and USA. So this is where you can see the accumulation which takes place of amyloid plaques, which are clumps of protein. They grow in the brain and these protein strands twist, damaging the brain cells, the neurons. And then brain cells dry, areas shrink and results in memory loss and progression of Alzheimer's disease. So this is there. And the Trojan horse, the idea of Trojan peptide, which has been taken from Trojan horse, was actually an idea of Odysseus. His army built a large wooden horse and hid members of the army and himself hid inside. And the Greeks offered this Trojan as a sign of surrender during the Troy War. And the Trojans accepted the gift as such and brought it inside the walls of their city. And at night, Odysseus and his men crept out and locked the gates of the city and the battle began. So that is a Trojan horse. It's also used for a program, an unauthorized program in computing. It is Trojan horse is an unauthorized program which contained within a legitimate program. So unauthorized program actually performs functions unknown to the user. So it has been it looks as if it's useful and it has come up, you have downloaded it, but then the Trojan as such results in harming your computer system and having negative developments taking place. So that is a Trojan horse. So you can see this was a huge wooden horse given as gift during the war. Enemy accepted this gift and they brought it into their kingdom, and during the night Greek soldiers who were hiding inside the horse came out. So any program that appears to be performing a desirable and necessary function, but that because of unauthorized code within it, which is unknown to the user, it performs unknown functions too, which may be undesirable for the user. So that is the concept of Trojan. So that is it. Thank you.